with me, but because he's good, we give him the glory. Amen. We give him the glory in this place. Father God, in the matchless name of Jesus, we give you glory, honor, and praise on this day. We praise you for your anointing, Lord God. We praise you for your power, Lord God, and your might, Lord God, in this place. Father, as I begin to decrease and you increase, Lord God, let the anointing word of God go forth with power and with might. Pressurize your women right now, Lord God, that they become warriors in the spirit and that they're able to tear down strongholds of the enemy, Lord God, and lift you up and give you all the glory and praise, which is righteously due your name. So, Father, we give you glory right now. We honor you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I'm not going to be before you really long, but I'm going to be before you because I have something to show you that God showed me.
Come on, come on.
And in that, I am recording that. In that, I want to show you what God showed me. It was just an awesome thing. But I'm going to show you not only by the word, but also by demonstration. Uh-huh. Because sometimes you get a better clue of what's going on when you begin to see it in the real thing, right? Because I can tell you all day long, but when you see it for yourself, you're going to understand this a little bit better. Our theme is iron sharpens iron, and it comes from Proverbs 27 and 17. And the word reads, as iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens and influences.
Right.
Another through discussion. I'm going to use as a subtopic pressurize. You've got to be pressurized in this thing. Hallelujah. And I'm going to take you over to Ecclesiastes, the 10th chapter and the 10th verse. Ecclesiastes, the 10th chapter and the 10th verse simply reads, if the iron is blunt or dull, if the iron is blunt and he or she does not sharpen its edges, then he or she must exert more strength. So if the iron is dull, then that means you're going to have to work at this thing.
Right.
It's not going to come easy. I mean, you're going to have to labor and toil at this thing. He said, if the iron be blunt, let's look at what an iron is. And Pastor Weston, you all in it. But girl, I love it because you set it up. Look at God. See, that's what I like. You know you're in the right place when God is moving and the word is similar but different. It says, let's look at an iron. I was in the element chart and I said, what is the element of iron? And you know the element is, the symbol is Fe.
Right.
This is a women's conference.
What is that?
How do we do this? The female part of the Fe. The feminine part of it.
Come on.
The feminine part of the iron being blunt. The feminine part of you being dull. Right? You're going to have to do something in this season, ladies. It's like you are the strongest part of your household. Yes. You are the strongest part. You build up, you birth out, you care for everybody in the house. So you can't go around thinking that you are weak in any way. Amen? Yes. It says Fe on the element chart. It is a gray metal used to make steel. Look at all the things that are made out of steel. You sit in a chair that's made out of steel. Don't tell me you ain't strong.
Yes.
Don't tell me you don't have the wherewithal to get it done.
Right.
Because listen, you sitting in a chair, you didn't see nothing but you just sat down.
Yeah.
The strength of that chair is in you.
Yeah.
You are the female part to this arm. It is a magnetic type of metal.
Come on, drawing.
It said it rusts in the air, but it's magnetic. Do you know that the arm in your body is in your bloodstream?
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Do you know that women need more iron than most men?
Right. Right.
Do you know that we're cyclic, right?
Right.
Do you know where I'm going?
Right.
So as you shed, God gives you more.
Right.
As you honor and watch out for your sister, God gives you more.
Yeah.
So you can always continue to know that God's going to keep filling you.
Yeah.
Because you are the vessel that he chose to be filled with this thing called iron. So you cannot tell me in this season that iron does not sharpen iron and that you're not already sharp. See, what happened is the devil got busy in Eve, in the garden, and he told Eve, you ain't nothing. I can take you down. And yes, he did. But then Jesus Christ came and said, you stronger than that.
He
said, you are the iron that is going to overtake this word is by you, by you teaching your sons and your daughters. It's by you as you minister to them. It's by you that they're going to get everything done. It's by the words that are coming out of your mouth. So when you begin to speak, speak life to your kids. Speak life to yourself. Speak life in season. Speak life out of season. Because the enemy is tearing them down. So if we're going to sharpen one another by the words of our mouth and by our countenance, then we got to change some things. And one of the things you're going to change is what's coming out your mouth. Because your mouth is a double-edged sword, right? It can cut both ways.
Right.
And people say, sticks and stones hurt, but break my bones, but words do not hurt. That's that is a lie. Words do hurt. Watch what comes out of your mouth. You can hurt somebody and not even know you hurt them. Being insensitive, not caring, not looking at their situation, being ineffective in the things that you're doing. And you're talking sometimes just to be hearing yourself talk. You don't have nothing good coming out of your mouth. And what you're talking about don't mean nothing to nobody anyway. Do you think God cares? If you ain't talking about what God has put in you and putting that out to the person next to you, then you're just talking to be talking. Listen, ladies, we got to be careful in this season. Iron is not only that, but iron is a device that we use to smooth out wrinkles. Lord Jesus. And so you know what? I don't know about you, but there's been wrinkles in my life that had to be smoothed out, you know. So we had to plug in the iron and we had to what? Heat it up.
Yeah.
And once we heated that iron up and began to iron that shirt, it became smooth. You were able to put it on and look right in it, and the Spirit of the Lord was on top of it, and they said, "Ooh, that looked good." But had I walked out here in my old wrinkly little shirt, you would have been like, "What is wrong with?" You know, that's the emergency room after people coming into church.
Right.
So you're going to have to have them come into church, and you're going to have to get your iron out. You say, "Baby, come over here. Take that off. Let me press it for you. Take that off and let me give you some word. Take that off and let me minister to you. Take that off and let me give you some clothes to wear to church. Because right now you don't have nothing to wear to church, but I got a little something I can give you. Take that off. You know, I heard you was hungry. Stop by my car and pick up that stuff in the trunk." You know what? You're going to have to start doing these things. Because see, you looking at what they see right in front of you, but what they're hurting, they're hurting. They're hurting. They're hurting in deep places.
Yes,
so when I talked about discernment, you got to know a spirit of discernment. You know what? She come in here every Sunday, and she has this look on her face. Are you watching her, or you just see her walk by? Are you really looking into her spirit, or are you just seeing her walk by? See, one of the things I learned about God, I have a kinetic attachment to the Spirit of God. When he begins to move, I begin to feel him moving. I can touch you and know exactly the pain you're going through. But that's a gift that God gave. You know, and it's not always pleasant, because I may tell you, you know, you got a lot of pain inside of you. Oh, God. But that's a gift that he gives you. Can you discern that with the person sitting next to you? Because I believe the person next to you is going through something. Do you know what she's going through? Can you discern how much hurt she's in right now? Or how much pain she may be in right now, this minute? See, these are the things we gotta ask of God. He said, this is what you need to be sharpened. That's why your edges need to be sharpened. So that you can discern and see these things that are moving in the person next to you. I don't care if you live in a high hill, on a high hill, and you got a beautiful house and 4 or 5 cars and money in the bank. That don't mean you don't hurt.
That's right.
Sometimes the more you have, the more hurt you have. See, people are always pulling on you this way and pulling on you that way. You know, and you giving over here and you're giving over there and you're trying to be this to that person and that to them. He said you can't do that.
Thank
you,
God.
Your arm needs to be sharpened so that you can turn around and say, "Baby, I can't do that.
Thank you, Lord.
I love you, but I'm not going to do that. I love you, but I can't be in that place today. I love you, but I'm not going to sit in this conversation with you today, because the conversation that you're having has nothing to do with me. And then on top of that, it has nothing to do with God." What that have to do with God?
That's it right there.
What that have to do with God? Some conversations you need to shut down.
Shut
shut them down. It's like, we're not going to have that conversation. I don't even care about that. Because what does that have to do with God? So we get caught up in the things of the world and forget that we need to be sharp and on point. And if you still keep sticking around people that are dull and blunt, they will make you dull and blunt. You won't have no point in your conversation. You won't know how you'll be ineffective in everything you do. It's like, check the people around you. Start looking at the people around you. And start looking at them and go, what are you giving me? What are you doing for me and the kingdom of God? How are you helping me and the kingdom of God? And then you got to look at yourself. And you go, now how am I helping you with the kingdom of God? How am I allowing you to be sharpened and on point and knowing what God has to say? Amen. He said, don't be blunt in this season of spiritual warfare. You must be like the arm. And by blunt, I mean slow to perceive. Don't be slow to see what God is doing. You cannot be slow to feel what the Holy Spirit is doing. You cannot be slow to respond, nor slow to understand. The Bible says if you lack wisdom, what are you supposed to do? Ask. You cannot be slow to understand and respond what the Spirit of the Lord is doing. Not in this season. Because the enemy is trying to kill each and every one of us. As you get older, you begin to understand that a little bit more. As you've gone through something, you begin to understand that a little bit more. You know, when you don't have a testimony and they've been through nothing, you don't know nothing. I'm sorry, it's the truth. You really don't know. But go through being homeless. Go through being jobless. Go through no money. Go through some struggles. Go through some sickness. Go through some disease. Go through some people hating on you. Go through your boss not allowing you to move forward in the things that you need to do on your job. Go through some things, and then you'll have a testimony about how you made it over and how you got there. Because it wasn't because of what you did. It's because of the grace and mercy of Jesus Christ. Come on, somebody. We have not arrived. We have not all that.
That's right.
It's only by his grace and only by the mercy of Christ that we are able to stand and move in any direction. If it had not been for the Lord on my side, somebody said, oh God, where would I be? Now review it. Look back. Take a look. Because this is all your past. Where would you be? Yeah. Some things are scary to even think. If I had to stay the course that I was on, I'm going to say it again, if I had to stay the course that I was on, if my edges had not been sharpened by the Spirit of the Lord and by the word of the testimony of somebody else, where would I be? So these are the things that God is telling us. He said, don't be dull and have a no point. Okay, no sharpness, no concern about your ministry. You have no concern about your life. You have no concern about your family. God is calling you to be in ministry and to work in the church and do stuff. Put your hand to the plow and start helping move some things. And you concerned about yourself. Well, I ain't going over there because they always late and they don't never start on time. And I don't know why they want me to do it because so-and-so do it better than I do it. And you got 100 reasons why you can't do something. And the best one is I'm too busy. Busy doing what? That's what I want. What you busy doing? Because what you busy doing is not profiting you at all. But then you want to pray to God and you want to ask God, God bless me in this. Why? What are you doing? You want a blessing, but you know a blessing comes with something that you must do. They're just going to drop out of the sky and read Deuteronomy 28, and he's going to tell you, if you do this, then you will be blessed. But if you do that, you will be cursed. You better get this right. There's blessings and curses. But a blessing requires some action from you. Something you have to do. So in order to have your stone sharpened, you must know the blessings of the Lord. You have to know what God has put inside of you, and you got to know what he put in the word. How can you train someone? How can you encourage your sister if you don't know what God said? Listen, you got to take the things of the world and leave them in the world. But you got to take the things of God. Meditate on them. Put them in your spirit. Apply them to your life. Apply it. That means you got to do something. There's an action required when you do an application of something, right? So that means you got to put it inside of you and work this thing. Amen?
Amen.
Don't be dull and insensitive, having no regard or little regard for other people's feelings. Because now you're ineffective in the things of God. Ineffective. You're not doing nothing. Why are you doing it? Is it for you or is it for God? You know, check yourself. Sometimes you got to just check yourself. What are my motives? Why am I really doing this? Okay. Because see, sometimes it's just for show. As I want you to see me, see me, see me. Yes. I'm so great. I'm wonderful. Yes. It's like, no, you're not. Sit down.
That's right.
Sit down.
That's right.
You know, those that wrench around and shut down. You know, get back in the back someplace. This ain't about you. You cannot in this season disregard divine instruction. God is going to start giving you instruction. You cannot disregard the instruction of the Lord. If you have a relationship with God, then he will give you instruction. But I'm going to tell you this, you must follow the instruction exactly the way he gave it. If you are me, I will do it like this, but then I'm going to do it like that. That ain't what he said. You won't miss your blessing.
That's right.
You will not be sharpened. Because see, listen, when you're sharpened, it causes a little pain. It causes some pain.
Yes, come on now.
You know, and the pain you are not going to like, but you're going to have to disregard this pain knowing that there's a blessing on the other end. You're going to have to be able to go through and come out knowing that God is still blessing you. Amen? Dull this because you have a lack of prayer.
Come on.
You know, somebody say you prayed for I don't know how long this morning. Okay, well, okay. That's just here. You got to be at home. Because we pray all day at my house. Something about being single. You know what? I can pray every room. Oh God, the man said you got 2,500 square feet. And don't think I ain't laid out in every piece of that house. Get out of here. And to pray and stay in prayer all day. I love it, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You don't have a distraction. There is not a distraction. You know, you have women that I want to be married. You better marry a godly man. Because you ain't gonna lay out in 2,500 square feet of a house praying all day long. You're like, oh, where my meal? Talk to God. Where is this? Wash your clothes. The wash machine over there. I'm busy right now. I'm trying to seek God. You see what I'm saying? So you gotta be careful what you ask for. Because it really might not be what you want. It might not be what you want. So be careful with your relationship with God. Be careful because he's calling you into a place to increase you. You cannot be increased unless you follow the instructions. You cannot have the blessing unless you follow the instructions. So when the prophet comes and gives you instructions, follow the instructions. When God sends a word to you and he gives you an instruction, follow the instructions. You have a lack of worship. Yeah. There's a difference between prayer and a difference between worship. But you have a lack of worship. When I get before God, when I lay out before God, when I just allow myself to go into that secret place of the Most High God, where he covers you under the wings, where he ministers to you, you can worship in that place. You can cry out in that place. You got to be sharpened. Worship will sharpen you.
Yes.
Praise is for the victory.
Yes.
I'm excited that you did that. I'm excited that you brought it. I'm excited that it's done. It's for the victory. Oh, worship says, Lord, I trust you.
Yes, Lord.
I just trust you.
Yes.
I trust you. I know it don't feel right. I know it hurts when you're sharpening me. And I know it hurts when you make me go through. And I know it hurts when you say I can't have that. And I've been praying about this and praying about this and praying about this. And all you're saying is no. Why not? You know, you can ask God a question. Why not? He said, because I said no. Okay.
Amen.
What you going to do? Amen. That's right. That's exactly what you going to do. You just going to worship him. Just like he said no. I'm not going to worship him. I ain't going to do that. And you got to be okay with it.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it may not be what you want it to be. Good for you. just because you want it don't mean it's good for you. That's what I'm trying to tell you. You don't need it. Because you don't know what that's going to come on the other end. So just worship me and I'll tell you what you are going to have.
Jesus.
And a lot of times it's better than what you thought you
were. Amen.
That'll make you laugh. He said, that was better. He said, yeah, but you was trying to push the issue. And I'm trying to keep telling you, no.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah. See, you got to learn how to repent. Amen. You really got to learn how to repent to God. If you want to be sharper, you got to learn how to say, Lord, I was so wrong. I am so sorry. I am so sorry. Because, see, I was trying to do it on my own without allowing you to do what you needed to do. I'm sorry. See, that's the thing about David. David was a great warrior, but he knew how to repent. He said, Lord, I'm so sorry. David laying on the floor, watched the bed and died. Lord Jesus knew what was going on. And then the Bible said he perceived that the baby had died. They didn't come. Don't tell him. Don't tell him, because you know he already laid out. He might be sick. You don't still know what's going on. David said when they came in, he perceived that something had happened. He got up, washed his face, put his clothes on, and went about his business. God gave him peace in that thing. He gave him peace in it. And so this is what, to be sharpened, you're going to have peace. To be pressurized, God has got to strip some stuff off of you and then you'll have some peace. He's got to take some things, you know, and pressure hurts. Somebody, if you just put your hand on somebody and just push on them long enough, he'll be like, can't you get your hand off me, please? He thought he was gonna do that. He said, I'm gonna stick my hand right there and pressurize you until you get this. And then when you get it, I'll release it. And then when I release it, the glory will fall. And you will know that I was there all the time. And when you thought I wasn't there, I was still standing right there with you. That's why you didn't die.
Yes. Amen.
That's why you didn't end up in jail.
Amen.
That's why you didn't end up in a car accident and you ended up hurt. But you had an accident and walked away from it. Who does that? Nobody but God.
Nobody
got died.
That's right.
God says in this season, you cannot be blunt and having cares and worries and concerns. You cannot have a low or no spiritual relationship with the Father. You cannot have a sometimey attitude. You know, we're good at that one.
Yeah.
Because yes, when I'm in trouble, sometimes I might fast and pray. I might. I don't even know if I'm gonna do that. It's like, Lord, okay, Lord, I need this. It's like, that's all you gonna do? How important is that? He says some spirits don't come out unless you fast and pray. Then he says you need to seek my face. He said, He said, first thing you need to do, right? The very first thing he said, I need to seek your face. Early in the morning with our eyes. And seek your face and your counsel for today. So you can't have a sometime attitude. You gotta be consistent in this thing. You gotta be on point. If you wanna be sharpened, you gotta be on point. Listen, Monday through Saturday, you trying to work out a spiritual request with an earthly response.
Oh! That's good.
Say that again. Do you hear what I'm saying? I said you trying to work out a spiritual request with an earthly response. You know you ain't gonna get nothing out of that. Nothing at all. A spiritual request, and you try to call your sister. Girl, what you think about this? What you think about that? She don't know. You cannot take a spiritual request and try to think you earthwise. You're gonna work this thing out. It's gonna require a spiritual response. If you do not have a relationship with God, how will you know when the Spirit comes in and when He gives you an answer to the question? How would you know when God showed up and showed out? Because it didn't look like what you thought it looked like, but He already blessed you through it. And then 2 days later, you're like, wow, that kind of worked out. You missed it.
Yeah.
You missed all of it.
Yeah.
You missed it when He showed up in the room. You missed it when He blessed you. You missed it when He said it for. You missed it when He proclaimed that you were going to be the ruler over this thing and not the enemy.
Come on. That's
you missed it.
You missed it.
God, pray for discernment. You cannot. Oh, God. How can I sharpen the countenance of my sister when I myself fool. I'm not sharp. I'm dull.
That's right.
I got issues.
Right.
I got things that need to be straightened out. See, you're so busy trying to help somebody else. Can you help yourself first?
Right.
You know what you're dealing with. What you're dealing with. What you're dealing with. What you're dealing with. See, you got to look at yourself and say, what am I dealing with? Because you know what? I got some issues myself. So I think I'll do this. Let me send you to the pastor.
Yes.
Let me send you to the bishop. Let me see you where you can get some help, because right about now, I may be going through the same thing, and I need to go with you. In fact, come on, let's go together.
Right.
I need the same answer you need right now. So we just, I tell you what, I'm going to be my sister's keeper, and me and my sister, let's go.
Let's go.
Let's go. So in order to be sharpened and have your edges sharpened, you got to realize some things. He said, the word of the Lord says that you have to be sharpened in this season. You cannot be dull. You cannot be blunt. He said, if the iron is blunt and you do not sharpen the edge, then you must exert more strength. All right, I'm going to show you something. That, for all of you to know, that's a sharpened stone, okay? That's called a whetstone. And see this whetstone right now, as she's sharpening it, it's not doing anything, it's just lying across. So if she wants that stone sharpened, she gonna have to apply some pressure. She gonna have to apply pressure in order to get it sharpened. Because this is what the word is saying. It says, if the stone, it says, hold on, let me get here. It says, if the iron is being blunt, he does not sharpen his edges, then she must exert more pressure. It'll take more strength in order to get that sharpened. So she's going to have to press on it to get it sharpened.
Yeah.
Okay? Because there ain't nothing moving. It's just sliding across a piece of steel.
Right.
You know, I had this in my drawer for a long time. Never knew what it was. Thank you, Pastor Darlene. You made me learn something. Now, what I want you to do is that, but if the stone be wet, if the stone be wet, I'm going to have to put it in the water.
Uh-huh.
If the stone be wet. And in the meantime, we're going to bring that knife. Bring that knife back to me. You see this? Do you have one of these? Everybody got one of these in your drawer someplace?
Yeah.
Do you use it?
Yeah.
Okay. This is called a horning tool. It's a horning tool. You know what it's used for? It's to straighten out the edge of your knife. I can Google this stuff, man. I'll roll it. So he said it sharpens out the edge of your knife, so it makes it straight. So you're going to have to horn in on some things about God. You're going to have to horn in on your relationship with God. You're going to have to horn in and get in position with God. You're going to have to horn in so he can straighten out your edges, because God knows our edges are blunt and unsharpened. Right? Okay, so we got edges right now that have no friction. There's nothing there. It's just an edge. You can take out a fly. If the enemy said, I'm going to send a bunch of flies to you, you would just be swatting with your hand. I have enough sense to get a fly swatter. So if there's a sharp edge, you say, get the fly swatter. A sharper edge, you say, go to a 99 cent store and get one of them little zap, and then automatically fly hit it and just kill it.
Yeah.
This is what sharpening your edges does. So when you're in prayer, if you want your edges sharpened, that's all you got to do, right? It says, horn in, beginning to straighten out the edges. The thoughts and actions of your daily movement will have purpose. It says, align yourself with the word of God. That's what the horning tool does. It will help you to align yourself with the word of God, to study to show yourself approved by God. You need to eat this word. You need to breathe this word. You need to drink the living water. You need to be in the word, and the word needs to be in you. The Bible says, let this word be in you as it was in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
So let's just test the edge of that. Is your knife sharp? It's still kind of dull. Okay. All right. God's going to be moving some stuff off of you. So see, when you go through the horning tool, that spirit of evil, he's moving it. That spirit. spirit of seduction, he's moving it. That spirit right now of jealousy, he's moving it. You see what I'm saying? So as you keep grinding on this stone, he keeps moving stuff off of you. So when you look at this, you're like, wow, I'm not the same woman I used to be. I can sit at the bar and drink all night long. I don't even want to drink. You know what? I can run the streets all night long. You didn't even think about running the streets. I figure out when the house of the Lord is open again. When is the church open? When can I go back and praise God a little bit more? When can I get into the presence of God? When can I lay out and pray some more? Why are you bothering me when I want to pray?
Yeah.
My God. So when God starts moving things off of you, then your countenance changes.
Yes.
Your thought process changes. Yes. The things that you desire change. You're not the same as you used to be, but now you have stepped into a new light. The darkness is gone, and the light of the Lord has begun to shine through you, because that's what you see. Now your eyes are open.
Yes.
Now you can see what God is saying to you. You got to align yourself with the word of God.
Yes.
Horn in for more accuracy.
Yes, Lord.
You know, you can't take the devil out unless you're accurate. You got to know what spirit you're fighting against. And you got to take that spirit that you're fighting against, and you got to know how to fight that spirit. Because the devil knows how to fight better than you know how to fight. Because you see what I'm saying? You used to be in his army. And he was manipulating you. And making you do things that you didn't need to do. But now that you're in the army of the Lord, you see there's a different fight going on. You got to learn how to love your enemies. You got to learn how to love those that mistreat you and talk about you. You know, you got to learn how to love those that do wrong against you. You hear what I'm saying? You got to learn how to love what you did not love and you used to talk about. Now you got to love it. Now you got to give to it. Now you got to be there for it. You know, when it was so easy before to go, I don't have nothing to do with her. I don't care if she or he, whatever. But now you got to love them. You got to hold them. You got to bring them up. You got to bring them through. You got to help with them. You got to horn in the stick, Lord God. Then we got the whetstone. You can bring in the stone.
Yes.
The whetstone in the natural, without it being wet, you see how it just slides across. When that stone went into the water, there's little bubbles that came up around the stone.
Right.
The bubbles that came up around the stone is like the Holy Spirit entering into you. When you are baptized in the Spirit of the Lord, you go in the water one way, but you're supposed to come up out of the water a different way.
Right.
So when the Holy Spirit gets in you, the little bubbles begin to feel those crevices and places that God needs to get into and move some stuff out of you so that the Spirit can move in you. And so this is what happens when the water, when the whetstone is submerged in the water, when you are baptized in the water, then the Lord God begins to fill you with his spirit. Submerged in the water, you get filled. When you start, you see the friction on it now? You see the friction on it now? See, this is what happens, what God does. After he baptizes you in the water and you start going through difficult times, it's just friction. But you're still sliding across it. You know, it's just friction. You're still sliding across it. You know, when you lay that knife prostrate on top of that stone and you just lay that on the stone and you better just slide the knife on the stone, it's just friction. When somebody's sick in the house and you don't know what to do, it's just friction. You know, when you lose your job, it's just friction. When you're sick in your body, it's just friction. And you're like, Lord, just keep sliding me across the stone. Because I've been dipped in the water, already been baptized, already been to the water, already know who the God of my life is. I already know what I can do. Because when you begin to cut me and you begin to worship and you begin to work with me, Lord God, on this wet stone, you got to wet the stone. You got to cry out. You got to allow the Lord to work in this thing. And when he does, he will strengthen you. How is your knife now? What is the edge of knife? Oh yeah, that edge is getting sharp. When I begin to tell you what God says, see, that begins to sharpen you in the spirit. When you begin to read the word of the Lord, it begins to sharpen you in the spirit. When you begin to recite the word of the Lord, meditate on the day and night, it begins to sharpen you in the spirit. When your friend comes to you with a bunch of mess, you begin to tell them, baby, you're not doing that today. And you're all right with saying that. And you say, now let's talk about what God can do in this situation. Let's change this situation. Let's change the thought process in your head. Let's talk about what God can do. We're not going to talk about what you just came through, but let's talk garden where evil is all around us. And there's nobody, not a one person that can stand and declare the works of the Lord. We cannot be in that situation. God did not call us to be in that situation. He said, you need to be sharpened. I must sharpen the edges. I will whet the stone. Then I will take the knife. And I will cut off everything on you that has no business being there. And you cannot be concerned about the pain of being cut. You ain't now, because you know victory is that when he finishes.
Thank you, God.
He said, when he has tried me,
yes.
He said, what Job said, when he has tried me, then I will come out as pure gold. When he has tried me, I got another metal now. I have gone from metal to gold. Hallelujah, Jesus. Ooh. I have been strengthened not only in my flesh, but I've been strengthened in my spirit. And now, because of the deity of God, which is golden, it's upon me, the light of the Lord, when it hits the gold, all you see is his glory.
That's right.
All you see is his glory. You don't even see what's behind the glory. You just see the glory. But that's because he's cut it off. That's because he's sharpened your edges. That's because he's allowed you to pour into somebody else so you can sharpen their edges. So listen what I'm telling you. You have to be in this season ready to be on that stone. You got to be ready to be baptized. You got to be ready for the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Many people say, I've been baptized, but have you been filled? Let's stop right there. Have you been filled? That's where you need to be. You got to be filled with the Spirit of the Lord. If you want his power, if you want to be able to pressurize something, if you want to be able to go forth with pressure and with might, you need to be filled. It's time to quit playing church. Because we know how to come in and we know how to go.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
But are you filled with the Spirit? The Spirit of God and not some other spirit.
Right. That's true.
People come into church with all kinds of spirits, but you got to be filled with the Holy Spirit. So God says, in order for you to be pressurized, you got to have faith. You got to believe what you cannot see. You got to believe what you do not know. You got to take the word of the Lord, and you have to stand on that word no matter what. Even when it don't look like something's going to happen, just take the word and stand on it. Recite the word back and forth to yourself until you get a revelation out of the word. Because sometimes you don't have you don't have anything, no proof, because you don't have no revelation. And you don't believe the word that you speak. Stay in that word till you believe the word, and then it becomes a part of you. You got to be the word of God. When it becomes a part of you, there's some truth. Now you can work the word. Now you can have some pressure in the word. Now you can move in this word. Now you can proclaim the word, because now you believe the word and you're believable to other people. But when you come to me with one thing and I'm looking at you going, you don't even believe that yourself. How you gonna help me?
Right.
I need you to be real with what you're doing. I need you to be real in the word of God. If you can be real in this thing, God will bless you in this thing. If you can be real, he will bless you. Because see, your sister may not know you're faking and shaking. But the Father knows. He knows when you're not being real. He knows when you're faking. He knows when you are getting. And sometimes he'll tell you, now you know you don't believe that. Because your actions, your character, your countenance says something different. You got to change the countenance of your sister. After you change your own countenance.
That's right.
A merry heart brings a merry countenance.
Right there.
Evil will bring a sad countenance. Decide today if you're going to be merry or evil. Read your Proverbs. Tell you that. Read your Proverbs in 27. Just read that chapter.
Right.
Which one you going to be? See, Proverbs gave us instruction, but it gave us choices. Everything in Proverbs says, if you're this, then you're this. But if you're that, then you're that. So you got to figure out if you are this or if you are that. If you believe in God or if you try to play God. What? Oh, you believe in. I know you're all about trust in this house. You go to church every Sunday. You pray without ceasing.
Right.
And all things you give and check, thanks. Because it shows in your countenance. It shows in the things that you're doing. More than anything else, on this day, we want you to leave from this place knowing that you have been sharpened. Get in your words, stay in your words. Get into prayer, stay in the prayer. Stay in the prayer. I tell you, that is your conversation with God. And when you're having that conversation, listen, ladies, there's a place where you need to shut up and listen. Because many times we talk. And God trying to tell you something, you talking over you. Jesus, you ain't gonna never get an answer. You have to be still. And you have to just meditate sometimes in some places so that he can speak to you.
Yes.
He is not gonna overpower you and try to outspeak you. Keep talking, you will never get this blessing. When you finish talking, then I'll show up and tell you what I'm trying to tell you. So stay in your word and stay in your prayers and meditate on the word day and night.
Thank you, God.
Sharpen your sister next to you.
Yes.
Sharpen your family members. Sharpen them so that the glory of God will be revealed in them. So remember, you want to wet the stone. Remember, you want to be baptized in the spirit.
Yes.
Not in your flesh.
Why?
In the spirit, there's a difference.
Yes.
And not in your flesh. Don't play God. Study the word of God. Know the word of God.
Yes.
And then that way you can move forward. Your edges will be sharp. Get your horn in tune. And horn in. Look at all the words. Look at everything God says. Know his promises. So he can enlarge your territory.
Yes.
So when he starts cutting, you're like, I'm good. I'm good.
Yeah,
I'm going through, but I'm good. I'm going through, and I love you anyway.
Yes,
I'm going through, but I love you, Jesus.
Yeah, right.
I'm going through, but I love you, Jesus.
Yeah.
I'm going through, but I love you, Jesus. They're talking about me, but I love you, Jesus. Oh, God, the car broke down, but I still love you, Jesus. I'm sick in my body, but I still love you, Jesus. Because you are on the whetstone. And he's sharpening you for victory. So, as I come to a close, all I have to tell you is that these are the things that the tools that you need, because that is a tool.
Yes.
He's going to give you tools in order to overcome this life, the complexities of this life. You need tools.
Yes, you do.
The Bible will give you tools to overcome it, but you have to know the tools, and you have to pick up the tools and use it. You got to put your hand to the plow. You got to do something.
Yes, you do.
Pick up the tools. Use them. Share the tools with somebody else. Quit telling people what you think. Tell them what the Bible says.
Right.
Do you hear what I'm saying? Well, I think, who cares what you think?
Right.
What did God say?
Right.
Because what you think and I think may be totally wrong.
Right.
And oftentimes it is.
Right.
But let's go to the Word. It's like, okay, hold on, let's go to the Word. Let's go to where your Bible at. And nowadays, you got a Bible on the phone. Come on, somebody. So you ain't got to go far. Google it. Ask Alexis. Ain't that her name? Alexis, what did God say about being obedient? Teach Alexis how to be a Christian. Ain't that the lady's name? I don't have one of them names in my house.
Listen.
Mother says she don't like to talk about religion. That's even more reason to bombard Google and tell Alexis you're going to be a Christian before the end of the day.
Yeah.
If everybody got on Alexa and started telling her, Alexa, tell me what God said about this. Alexa, tell me what God said about that. See, you got to take this database and change it.
Yeah.
But you can change it. You can change it. Tell Alexa, Alexa. Keep it in mind. That's a good idea, really. If we get every church, Everybody got one of them things in their house that we need. Everybody start talking to her about the church and start talking to her about the Bible. Let's see how much disruption she can cause in Google. We can have a good time. You know, and God will be glorified on that. He's like, you took that little robot and made the robot a Christian. Come on, somebody. We got the power. Come on, give God some praise. We have the power. We can do all these things, right? And God said he will give us strength. Sharpen her edge. There you go. So she can talk back to you about the Christian life. Amen. Amen. I give God praise and glory for this time before you. And I know that we are going to have, I think, a break.
Yeah, we have lunch.
Oh, lunch.